Christ, I've never seen a righteous man forsaken. And there are many Christians today who are asking God, why have you forsaken me? They are singing songs of God, remember me. God, don't pass me by. If a man who lived under that covenant of the blood of cows and bulls could boldly say, I have never seen a righteous man forsaken or his descendants begging bread. And today you are living in a new covenant of the blood of Jesus, the Holy Son of God, and you are still praying, remember me, don't pass me by. My friend, you are lost. You need to recover yourself. Recover yourself. Amen. Because that which the angels gave to him, already he had messed it up. He had broke it up. So, let God now show me your glory. Show me who you are. And he tells him, I'll make my goodness pass before you, and I'll proclaim my name. And now he begins proclaiming his name, and he tells him, I am the Lord God. That is Jehovah, the God with a personality, the God you can relate to. Then he says, merciful and gracious. God reveals himself to Moses and tells him, Moses, you know what? I am merciful and I am gracious. That is not what you'll hear from an angel. You can only hear it from God himself. Amen. He tells him, I am merciful and I am what? Do you know the law has no mercy and the law has no grace? That's why the law does not reveal the character of God. Amen. The law says an eye for an eye. If you remove my eyes, I do what? I remove your eyes. If you pluck off my teeth, I do the same to you. It's an eye for an eye. If you kill my brother and I find you, I kill you. The law has no forgiveness. The law has no mercy. But here, God says, I am merciful and gracious. Is mercy a good thing? Yeah. Is mercy a good thing? Yes. Is grace a good thing? Yes. You know, mercy means not being given what you deserve. You have killed. You deserve also to be killed. But your life is spared. That is mercy. Grace means receiving that which you don't qualify to receive. Amen. You are a poor performer in school. You got a D minus in school. You are so bad in academics. But the next thing we know, you are a CEO of a big, big company. That is grace, my friend. That is something you never qualify. In terms of academics, you don't. Amen. That is grace. We know where we came from. David says, I've been conceived in sin and all that. But thanks be to God, we are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Not because of our behavior. That is grace. That is grace. That is why we have to preach the gospel of grace. Paul says, the gospel of grace was entrusted to him. Because the gospel of grace, it reveals to us what we have received in Christ without qualification. The law speaks about what you have to receive by qualification. You have to behave to get it. But grace shows us what already we have received, minus qualifications, minus qualifying. He qualified the unqualified. I am the unqualified who has been qualified. Hallelujah. I am the righteousness of God. When God looks at me, he sees his righteousness in me. Not a sinner. So God says he's merciful. And he says he's gracious. Those are good attributes. Amen. Those are good things which all of us will like. God is gracious and is what? And he is merciful. He is gracious and is what? He is merciful. Mercy and grace, are they good things or bad things? And therefore, if somebody comes here and it begins preaching a God of thunder and destruction, is that mercy? When we go to pray and we begin pleading with God, please God, have mercy on Kenya. Eh? Between God and you, who needs to be told to have mercy? Eh? Please, God, have mercy on my family. Have mercy. Have mercy. Between you and God, who should be asking the other party to have mercy? That prayer is misplaced. Amen. Even if it is in the Bible, those people are not revelation of God. They have not seen God. They have never known God. Between God and me, it is God who should be asking me to be merciful, not me asking him. Because he is naturally merciful. That's why while we were yet sinners, before we asked him to have mercy, he died for us. Before you were born, before you sinned even one sin, Christ already took your sins on the cross. So who are you to ask him to have mercy? Hello? That is the simple truth between you and God, who is more merciful. Who should be asking the other guy to have mercy? Hallelujah. He says merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abounding in goodness and truth. Wow. God says he is long-suffering. Amen. And I'm telling you that is true. Because if God could be like some prophets we know around and some men of God who are going breathing fire in this country, we could be no more. Unasikia? We could be what? We could be no more. But because he is long-suffering, though these bad things have been happening, even after the event of the cross, people are still walking in sinful habits. Amen. In sinful behavior. Killing each other. A father killing his kids. A mother killing the husband. I mean, a woman killing the husband. Boyfriend killing a girlfriend. And all these things happening in our media every day. Yeah. Too much bloodshed. Too much immorality and all these bad things. If God was not long-suffering, then we could have been destroyed. But thanks be to God, it is his nature that he can bear with us. Hallelujah. God can bear with us because he is long-suffering. That's why you are there sitting down there and listening to me. Why? Because God is long-suffering. You know where you came from. You know what you've done before. But today you can still be hearing my voice. Why? Because God is long-suffering. And that one, it is his nature. Some of us, we give up very fast. In fact, even maintaining friendship nowadays becomes a challenge to many people. People can't bear with each other. If someone just speaks something bad against you in church, that is the end of you worshiping with them. And you say you are a Christian, you are born of God, you have the Spirit of God living in you, you have God's nature in you. That's a lie, my friends. Amen. If God is long-suffering, you can equally be long-suffering towards your friends. Eh? There are people today who can't talk to their parents. They can't talk to their relatives because of the things they did to them. Yes, they did it. It happened. But you have overcome it. Things have changed. Talk to them. Amen. Talk to them. Talk to them. That is God's nature. He's long-suffering. He bears with us. We must equally bear with others. He is long-suffering. And that's why this world still remains. Because God is what? God is long-suffering. He is long-suffering. And abounding in goodness and truth. Hallelujah. And abounding in goodness and truth. God is abounding. He is full of goodness. Not a little bit of goodness. Don't go praying, hoping that if God today has woken up in a good mood, he will do good to you. Go praying, understanding this, that God is abounding in goodness. And if you ask for a good thing, then you have gone to the right place. Will not scare you. You have gone where? To the right place, because this God, it is his nature to do good. He is abounding. He is full of goodness. He is full of goodness. And James writes and he says, every good and every perfect gift comes from where? Comes from above. From the Father of lights, with whom there is no variableness or a shadow due to turn. Is a God who is not about to change his mind? No, he is pure goodness. He is a trillion volts of goodness. You can't exhaust his goodness. This word has been there for those thousands of years. People have been doing bad, bad things, but the sun still rises. Because you can't exhaust the goodness of God. Hallelujah. The sun still rises. The rain still comes. People are still eating. They are still planting and harvesting. Why? Because you can't exhaust his goodness. He is abounding in goodness. Even the murderer who killed last night, right now, he is breathing the same oxygen you are breathing. Why? Because he is abounding in goodness. Do you hear that? He is abounding. He is full and full of goodness. Hallelujah. If you go to God looking for bad things, for wickedness in him, it's like going to McDonald's or to Kenchik shop and you're asking for a Mercedes spare part. Will you get it? Eh? You won't. Because he doesn't sell there. There's no evil in God. There's no wickedness in God. Amen. In fact, when we sin, we think it is God who punishes us. But people don't know that sin itself has its own wages. It says the wages of sin. Not the wages of God. It is the wages of what? Which means if you sin, expect the wages. Even if God does not lift a finger, the wages will still come. Minus God being involved. Minus who? He will not lift a finger to hit you. But sin has its wages. And God knows how painful those wages are. That's why he's fighting to get us out of sin. Because he understands the pain which sin can cause. The suffering, the destruction, the humiliation which sin can cause in people's lives. That's why he hated sin so much that he had to become sin himself to deal with sin in our flesh. Because he knows that sin will destroy us from who we really are. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Bona sifiwe. It's like a parent who understands what fire is. And you see your child playing next to fire. What do you do? And this child doesn't know the effects of fire. What do you do? Eh? I'm a boiling water. Imagine a chemka pale kwa stove. And this kid goes near the stove there. Where the water is boiling. Will you sit back and look and say, hey, utajifunza leo. You will learn today. And you will know. Any parent who is normal enough will run. Will run. And shout and go and get that kid as quickly as possible. That is what Jesus did. When he saw man falling in sin, he came himself. He never sent an angel. He came himself to deliver us from sin because he knew the destruction sin has on us. Praise the Lord. So he says, long-suffering, abounding in goodness, and in truth. Hallelujah. God is abounding in truth, which means whatever God says today, he will not change tomorrow. If God says, I'll bless you, or I have blessed you, that is it. There's no day you'll wake up and he says, you know, that day I wasn't serious. You know, I blessed you, but I never thought clearly. Eh? I never thought well, but I just blessed you, but siku fikiria sana ndani. Sikuwa nimeambiwa hii na hii juu yako. Lakini sasa mara sasa nimeelezewa vizuri. Sasa naona ni kama nita. Eh? When God says, I'll bless you, he sticks with his word. Because he is abounding in truth. Not some little truth. We are told grace and truth came by who? And Jesus says, I am the way, and I am the truth, and I am the life. Do you hear that? Jesus is fullness of truth. He is a billion volts of truth. That whatever he says, that is what it is. Hallelujah. That's why he had the audacity of correcting the prophets. He could say, you have heard in your law, it is said so and so, but I say unto you. Why? Because he's the truth. Amen. Those people missed him. But now he comes here enforcing what it is the truth, because he is the truth. He is the epitome of truth. Hallelujah. And he says, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. Praise the Lord. As we grab this truth, as we understand about Jesus, the understanding of Jesus gives us the liberty that we have been looking for in life. Because in knowing Christ, we discover ourselves. We discover we have been born of the same seed. We discover we are from the same origin. We have the same father. He is the firstborn among many brethren. Hallelujah. We are one with him. That whatever God says, that is how it is. There are many Christians who are still praying to God, asking God to bless them. When God already has said that I have blessed you with every blessing in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. There are many who are still crying and asking God, please sanctify me. They are singing songs which are bringing forth the idea of them being in need of sanctification and cleansing. When God says already, I have sanctified you, I have justified you, I have made you righteous, you are a royal priesthood, a peculiar people, a chosen nation, a people belonging to God to proclaim his praises. Amen. He is abounding in truth. What he says, that is the truth. That is the truth. And will never change his mind tomorrow. Because he's abounding in truth. Amen. You can take it to the bank that what God says will come to pass. It doesn't matter what you are feeling today. It doesn't matter you woke up this morning, there was no tea in your house, there was no sugar. The landlord was knocking at the door, you had nothing to tell him. And if God says, I have blessed you, I have prospered you, let me tell you, these things, they will come to pass. And it came to do what? It came to pass because they are passing. What God says remains and abides forever. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Because he's abounding in truth. Whatever he says is true. He says abounding in truth. But he says keeping mercy for thousands. Some versions say keeping mercy for 1,000 generations. Amen. Keeping mercy for thousands of generations, or for 1,000 generations. He keeps mercy. Which means even if we live thousands and thousands and thousands and billions of years in this planet, we can't exhaust God's mercy. Look at that. This world is not big enough to exhaust God's mercy. There has never lived a human being who has been too wicked enough to exhaust the mercy of God. Do you hear that? Even Judas, it is him who hanged himself, not God who hanged him. He did what? He felt so guilty. He felt so remorseful until he hanged himself. Amen. And today there are many Christians who have felt so guilty and so remorseful, and they have hanged themselves by walking away from God. And they say, you know, I used to be a good Christian. I used even to preach, but you know what? I backslid. They did something. Guilt filled their hearts. And they said, wow, I'm hanging my boots. And they hung themselves. They hung their walk with the Lord. And they walked away. And you are told by the church there, you know, God is so tired of you. We have warned you the first time. The second time, you have still continued this thing. And so, and even God is tired with you. He's tired with you. God is never tired. You can't exhaust his mercy. It doesn't matter how many times you have fallen into the same trap. God will still get you out. That's why David said, a righteous man can fall 7 times. Which means he can fall and fall. Not only 7 times, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. He can fall and fall and fall and fall. And still fall. A righteous man can fall 7 times. But still does what? Rises up and walks. So if you fail, my friend, it's time to rise up and walk again. Don't hang your boots. Rise up and walk again. Because God's mercy extends to thousands of generations. Your children will experience his mercy. Your grandchildren will experience his mercy. Your great grandchildren. In fact, David says, I have been young and now I am old. Yet I have never seen a righteous man forsaken or his descendants doing what? Begging bread. He says, I have been young, now I'm an old. I've never seen that one happening. Which means he was very sure that his generation and the ones to come after him and after him will still experience what? God's mercy. Because his mercy is always abounding. It's always there for thousands of generations. Hallelujah. He says, I've never seen a righteous man forsaken. And there are many Christians today who are asking God, why have you forsaken me? They are singing songs of God, remember me. God, don't pass me by. If a man who lived under that covenant of the blood of cows and bulls could boldly say, I have never seen a righteous man forsaken or his descendants begging bread. And today you are living in a new covenant of the blood of Jesus, the Holy Son of God. And you are still praying, remember me. Don't pass me by. My friend, you are lost. You need to recover yourself. Recover yourself. Recover yourself. Hallelujah. Because he lives in us. He cannot pass us by. Abounding in mercy and abounding in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands. Then it says, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin. Remember here, Moses has been seeking mercy from the angels. It never worked. Now he goes to God and God tells him, you know what? I'm God who forgives. I forgive iniquities, transgression, and sins. And that is what Moses wanted to hear. That is what he has been pleading for. And now God tells him, yani God exposes his weaknesses to Moses. Do you know God has a weakness? Bonasifiwe. Do you know God has a weakness? Do you know God's weakness? Eh? God has a weakness of forgiving. That is the weakness of God. That is the weakness of God. God has a weakness of forgiving. That is why Jonah, he is sent to Nineveh. These Ninevites have been oppressing the Jews. And in his mind, he wanted God to destroy the Ninevites. But he knew very well, if I go there, God will forgive them. He knew. He knew God has a weakness of forgiving. So what does he choose? He chose to go opposite. Because he knows, if I go there, surely, as the Lord lives, he will forgive them. God has a weakness of forgiving sins. That's why you see Jesus, even before the cross, a man is brought to him. He's having a meeting in a Pharisee's house. And the house is packed. And they had a man sick of palsy, paralyzed. And they wanted Jesus to heal him because they knew he can heal. But there was no access. What do? They open up the roof of the house. And they lower this man down. When Jesus sees this man, he tells him, your sins are forgiven. One as if you were. Does it surprise you that this man never confessed his sins? Eh? This man never asked to be forgiven sins. Why was he forgiven minus asking? God has a weakness. His weakness is forgiving sins. That is why in Christ Jesus, all our sins were taken away. Hallelujah. All our sins were taken away in Christ Jesus. God forgave us all our sins. Praise the Lord. And Paul writes and he says, we have received redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. Ephesians 1 verse 7. We have received redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. The one tells you what? It tells you the riches of grace is the fact that God forgives sins. Amen. That is the riches of God's grace. And the glory. He says in verse 6, and we have been accepted in him. The glory of God's grace is the fact that we have been accepted in the beloved. We have been accepted in him by the glory of God's grace. God's glory reveals how we have been accepted. And the riches of grace reveals how we have been forgiven. So walk with the understanding that there is no cinema of your sins waiting you in heaven. You have been accepted. You have been forgiven. And God does not record any sin against you, because love keeps no record of what? Of wrongs. There's no record of wrongs. There's no account of sins in heaven waiting for you. That is the nature of God. He is abounding in goodness and truth. His mercies endures to thousands of generations. He forgives sins, iniquities, and what? Transgressions. And that is his weakness. Praise the Lord. That is his weakness. Then he goes further and he says this, and by no means clearing the guilty. That is now where the religious mind gets confused. How does God say he forgives sins? How do you say you are God who forgives sins, and you say you shall by no means clear the guilty?